हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू क्लास सेवन्थ। आवर वेरी फर्स्ट चैप्टर इन साइंस इज न्यूट्रिशन एंड प्लांट्स। एज वी ऑल आर बीइंग अवेयर दैट फूड इज़ द मेन सोर्स ऑफ न्यूट्रिशन इन ऑल लिविंग ऑर्गेनिजम्स, सो हियर वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अबाउट हाउ प्लांट्स गेट देयर न्यूट्रिशन। न्यूट्रिशन मीन्स नॉरिशमेंट। बेसिकली इट इज़ द प्रोसेस ऑफ टेकिंग फूड एंड इट्स यूटिलाइजेशन बाय द बॉडी। In plants, there are mainly two modes of nutrition. First one is your autotrophic mode of nutrition, which means those organisms which can prepare their own food. They are also known as autotrophs, for example, green plants. Another mode of nutrition in plant is heterotrophic mode of nutrition, which means those organisms which are dependent on other plants or animals for their food requirements are called heterotrophs. In plants, heterotrophs are further recategorized into four categories. First one, insectivorous plants, second, parasitic plants, third, symbiotic plants, and the fourth one is saprophytic plants. Now students, we are going to understand what is autotrophic mode of nutrition. Auto means self and trophos means nourishment. So it is the mode of nutrition in which plants make their own food with the help of simple substances obtained from the environment. And those organisms which make their own food are called as producers or autotrophs. For example, green plants. Students, you have already studied in your previous class about the process by which plants make their own food. This process is known as, yes, it is known as photosynthesis. Photo means what? It means light, and synthesis means putting together. So it is the process by which green plants prepare their own food in the presence of sunlight. Now I am telling you some of the essential conditions for the photosynthesis. First one is chlorophyll. In green plant there is a chloroplast cell. Inside this chloroplast there is a granum structure. Granum contains the chlorophyll. So the main purpose of chlorophyll is to absorb the sunlight. So the second essential condition for the photosynthesis is sunlight. Third essential condition is carbon dioxide, which is being taken by the plant through the stomatal opening. These stomatas are present at the lower surface of the leaf. From these openings, carbon dioxide gas is being absorbed by the plant. And the last condition essential for the photosynthesis is water and minerals, which are being absorbed by the plant through their root system. Now students, you are being aware with the essential conditions for the photosynthesis process. So I am showing you how photosynthesis being take place. Sunlight is absorbed by the chlorophyll. Carbon dioxide gas is being absorbed from the atmosphere through the stomatal opening in the plant, and water is being absorbed from the root system. When these four essential conditions are being fulfilled, then it get converted into the glucose, water and oxygen. So here comes the equation for photosynthesis, which is as follows. 6 molecules of carbon dioxide plus 12 molecules of water combined in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll get converted into glucose plus 6 molecules of water and 6 molecules of oxygen. Hence, the importance of photosynthesis is as follows. First, the food synthesized by this process is used by all living organisms. Second, oxygen released by this process is used for respiration in living organisms. Third, it maintains the ratio between the oxygen and carbon dioxide gas in the atmosphere. So now we come to the second mode of nutrition in plants, which is known as your heterotrophic nutrition. It is the mode of nutrition in which a living organism depends on other organisms for its food, and those organisms are known as your heterotrophs. In plants, there are basically four types of heterotrophic plants. First one is your parasitic plant, second one saprophytic plant, third insectivorous plants, and the fourth one is your symbiotic plants. We are going to take it one by one. Firstly, we are going to take the parasitic plant. Parasite, as the word represent you, parasite, those plants which reside on other plants for the nutrition requirement, they are called your parasitic plants. So basically there is a host and a parasite. Host is that plant which provides nutrition to the parasite, and the, as I already told you, parasite is the plant which absorbs the nutrition from the host. So the interaction between the host and parasite is known as your parasitic mode of nutrition. Basically, parasitic plants are non-green plants which are not capable to make their own food. For such kind of requirements, they depended on their host. I explain this with the help of an example. Firstly, I am taking you about the cuscuta. As you can observe the yellowish structure, this is the cuscuta. Cuscuta is also known as dodder or amarbel. As it is yellowish structure, which represents that it doesn't contain any kind of chlorophyll, which means it is not capable to perform the photosynthesis process. Hence, for their food requirements, they are dependent on their host plant. Another example is your milestone. Milestone is a partial parasitic plant which is capable to make their own food, but it doesn't have any proper root system, because of which it is dependent on its host plant. Now we come to the second heterotrophic plant, which is saprophytic plants. Sapro means decayed matter and phytes means plant. It means those plants which are dependent on dead and decay organic matter, they are called your saprophytic plants. And how they make their food on dead and decay organic matter? They release some kind of enzymes on the dead and decay matter, which get converted that decay matter into a liquid form, which is absorbed by these saprophytic plants. And basic examples of saprophytic plants are mushroom, bread mold, and the Indian pipe. Now we come on the third mode of heterotrophs. Third mode is your insectivorous plants. As the word represent you, insectivorous, it means they eat the insects. But why? Basically, they eat the insects because they grow in such kind of soil which are nitrogen deficient. It means to compensate their nitrogen need, they eat the insects. And for this, they get modified their leaves into such kind of traps which help them to hold the or to trap the insects. So these examples are here for the insectivorous plants, like pitcher plant. You can observe the pitcher plant. In pitcher plant, the plant modified its leaves into the funnel like structure to in which they can trap the insect easily. Second one is your Venus flytrap. They make their leaves into a broad, spiny, flat trap in which they can trap the insect. Third one is your bladderwort. Bladderwort having a bladder inside it, in which when insect get enter inside it, they trap that particular insect. And the fourth one is your sundew, in which they modified their leaves into sticky, spiny structures. So whenever an insect sit over there, they trap or they stick or they hold that particular insect in their structure. Now we come to the fourth mode, that is called your symbiotic plants. Symbiotic, these are the plants which live in association with other plants and share their shelter and their nutrients. So we call them as your symbiotic plants, and the association between these two different plants is called your symbiosis. Basically, in this relationship, both the plants get mutually beneficial. It means they both get benefited from each other, like in lichens. Lichen is what? Basically, it is an association between a green alga and a non-green fungus. I again repeat, what is lichen? Lichen is an association between a green alga and a non-green fungus, which means the fungus provides shelter to the algae and alga provides food to the fungus. As you all are being aware, alga is green in color, which means it is having a chlorophyll, so it can perform photosynthesis. So alga prepare food for the fungus and fungus provides shelter to the alga, and their association together is known as your lichens. There is a fact about the lichens is that lichens are very, very sensitive to air pollution. They grow only in non-polluted areas. The lichen reasons, they also know, this is the reasons lichens are also known as the indicator of air pollution. Our second mutual beneficial relationship is between the leguminous plants and the rhizobium bacteria. Leguminous plants, basically the grams and the moong dal which we are taking in our food diet, these plants are known as your leguminous plants. So in the root of these leguminous plants, there are the nodules in which a bacteria reside known as your rhizobium bacteria. Basically all the living organisms, whether it is a plant or an animal, they are not able to take the nitrogen gas directly in their body. So what they need, there is a bacteria in the soil known as your rhizobium. These rhizobium bacteria convert the atmospheric nitrogen into nitrate, and then this nitrate is absorbed by the leguminous plants, and in this way leguminous plant get nitrate. And what the rhizobium bacteria get from the leguminous plant? It gets the shelter and food from the leguminous plants. In this way, they both get mutually benefited from each other. This is another cause that we call that leguminous plants also beneficial to the farmers, because they replenish all the nutrients in the soil. These leguminous plants help in retaining the nitrogen content of the soil, and in this way they protect their soil from the fertilizers and external manures, and in this way the fertility of soil is also get maintained by the help of the leguminous plants. So this mutual beneficial for the plants also, both the plant and the bacteria get mutually benefited from each other. Also the soil and the farmers get benefit with this kind of mutual association. Students, now the chapter is being finished. Thank you for your support. Thanks.